The Delta variant is almost like a whole new COVID virus, as it behaves very differently from the previous COVID strains. It has at least three mutations on its spike protein, and more specifically on its receptor-binding domain. That's the part of the spike protein that binds to the ACE2 receptor on the cells in your body. The Delta variant's mutations help it bind more efficiently to the ACE2 receptor, and also allows the virus to enter the cell easier. Also, its mutations allow it to better evade the body's immune system. The Delta variant has caused COVID cases in the U.S. to rise over 300% over the past month, along with similar increases in hospitalizations and deaths. The Delta variant is estimated to be at least 60% more transmissible. One CDC document suggests the Delta variant is about as transmissible as chickenpox, with each infected person infecting, on average, 8 or 9 other people. Now compare that to the original strain of COVID, which was about as contagious as the common cold, with each infected person infecting 2 others on average. Studies on people infected with Delta variant showed that the fully vaccinated had as much virus in their bodies as unvaccinated people did. That doesn't mean worse infection, though, if you're vaccinated. But the significance of having those higher viral loads is going to mean higher transmission of the virus, either vaccinated or not, even if they don't have symptoms. It's why the CDC says that even vaccinated people should wear masks in areas of sustained or high transmission. Also, a study in China found that viral loads of people infected with Delta were 1,000 times higher compared to people infected at the very beginning of the pandemic. And Delta transmits in 4 days compared to 6 days when you compare that to the original strain. Now, there are 3 somewhat older studies from Canada, Singapore, and Scotland showing that people infected with the Delta variant are more likely to end up in the hospital. So does the Delta variant make unvaccinated people more prone to dying compared to the original strain? Hard to know, since there are currently no studies showing that one way or another. It's also trickier to answer this question because you're comparing apples to oranges. You're not only comparing different strains, but with the original strain, no one was vaccinated in 2020. Also, in the beginning of the pandemic, we weren't using things like dexamethasone and tocilizumab, 2 drugs that we now use to treat COVID because we know that they reduce mortality. With the mRNA vaccines we have, Pfizer and Moderna, they're about 95% effective at preventing serious COVID illness. So we know that even before the Delta variant emerged, there are going to be breakthrough cases. The CDC released a study examining an outbreak in Massachusetts where 74% of people who got infected had been fully vaccinated, and 4 of them ended up being in the hospital. Now, testing showed that the Delta variant made up 90% of those cases, but overall, still, most of the virus is spread by unvaccinated people. The CDC reported a total of 6,500 breakthrough cases, including 6,200 hospitalizations and 1,200 deaths as of July 26. Now, at that time, more than 163 million people in the U.S. were fully vaccinated against COVID. But here's a pretty impressive stat. Less than 0.004% of people who've been fully vaccinated experienced a breakthrough infection resulting in hospitalization, and less than 0.001% have died from the disease. In the early stages of the pandemic, my sickest patients in the ICU were mostly older people with chronic health issues, or younger patients, but they were obese or had diabetes. But now, with the Delta variant, things are looking different. Recently, I've been seeing more patients in the ICU who have chosen not to get vaccinated. In their 30s, in their 40s, their 50s, most of them are otherwise healthy. All of them not vaccinated. Just yesterday, a patient of mine was a guy in his early 40s, otherwise healthy. Now, he's still in the hospital getting the most amount of oxygen he can without a ventilator. And he's scared because he's on the brink of requiring a breathing tube, a ventilator. He didn't get the vaccine, and I asked him, why not? And there's one word he gave me. He said, stubborn. So then I asked him if he regretted not getting it, and he said yes. And this is the case throughout the country. We hear all these stories in the news of people who became seriously ill with COVID, and then they regretted not getting the vaccine.
Janine is speaking out now because she wants people to know how much she regrets not getting the vaccine, a decision that nearly cost her her life.
I was one of those people that was like, I can't believe people are just going to just inject their body with this medication. We don't know enough about it. Now I'm just like, it is just a shot. Just get the stupid shot. That vaccine could have stopped all of this. Just one little shot. And I feel foolish that I didn't get it.
Which, by the way, just because you get a double lung transplant doesn't mean that you are out of the woods. That man will be immunosuppressed for the rest of his life so that his body doesn't reject the transplant. About half of Americans remain unvaccinated. Unvaccinated people make up 97% of all COVID hospitalizations and 99.2% of deaths. Hundreds of Americans are suffering or dying every day from a vaccine-preventable illness. And some say, well, if they refuse the vaccine and die, then that's on them. But it's more than that. There are people who can't get the vaccine, at least not yet, like children less than 12. Then you have people who are immunocompromised, and they don't get that same protection from the COVID vaccine as compared to those who are not immunocompromised. Then you look at the financial cost of being hospitalized with COVID. Big hospital bills, mostly paid for by the taxpayers. The fact that we still can't ditch masks. But so far, the vaccines have saved an estimated 275,000 lives and prevented over 1 million hospitalizations in the U.S. alone. And by now, we all hear about the misinformation out there that deliberately twists the truth or flat-out lies or misleads people. Well, that has consequences. People struggle to make the best decisions for themselves and for their loved ones. People can die as a result of false or misleading information. And that was part of the reason why I started this YouTube channel in the first place before the pandemic. I wanted to provide accurate health information to combat the sea of BS floating out there. And it's also why the U.S. Surgeon General, Dr. Vivek Murthy, has called COVID-19 misinformation an urgent threat to public health. But in reality, it's been an urgent threat since the beginning. Whenever I have patients in my pulmonary clinic who tell me they don't want the vaccine, I listen to the reasons they give me. It's typically things like the vaccine development was rushed, or hasn't been studied enough, or that it's not yet FDA approved. Now, this is despite the fact that the vaccine was assessed for safety in over 70,000 people in the initial Pfizer and Moderna clinical trials. The vaccines met the FDA's rigorous scientific standards for safety, effectiveness, and manufacturing quality that's required to give its emergency use authorization, or EUA. Then you look at the almost 350 million doses of vaccine given in the U.S. so far. Overall, they've been shown to be very safe and very effective. So right now, it has the FDA EUA, but the full FDA approval is coming soon, probably in a couple months. That process takes time. That's always been the case. For those who aren't willing to get the vaccine because they don't want to be guinea pigs, now many of those people are willing to take medicine that's either much less studied or proven to be either unsafe or ineffective. For example, patients in Arkansas who ran to the pet store to buy ivermectin gel, thinking that's their solution for COVID. Pretty much every therapy that hospitals have used to treat COVID, like dexamethasone, remdesivir, hydroxychloroquine, and monoclonal antibodies like bamlanivimab and tocilizumab, the studies on those drugs pale in comparison to the vaccine studies because of the much smaller numbers to draw from. And with the evidence that we do have, the only ones that really have shown benefit are dexamethasone and, for very severe COVID, tocilizumab, and that's it. Men might be concerned that the vaccine could mess with their sperm counts or sperm quality. That has been proven to not be the case. Many young women might be concerned about infertility or miscarriage or breastfeeding, despite there being no evidence to support those concerns. Actually, there's a lot of data showing that the vaccine is safe before and during pregnancy, and it's recommended by both the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists and the American Society for Reproductive Medicine. Now, on the contrary, actually getting COVID presents a real risk to mother and baby. Pregnancy increases a woman's risk of having severe COVID. They're also more likely to go into premature labor, and their baby is more likely to require admission to the intensive care unit. The only true medical exception to not getting the vaccine is if you've had a severe allergic or immunological reaction to any of the components of the vaccine, like polyethylene glycol. Outside of that, we know that it's very safe and very effective and the key to getting past COVID. It's only a matter of time before a new variant emerges that will render our current vaccines useless. So until we reach herd immunity, we'll be in an ongoing battle of updating the vaccines to fight the new variants.